And welcome to TCAM Thursdays, your midday cultural break. I'm Denise Sherman, the executive director, and I am so excited today about our program because we are going to have an awesome conversation with two very special guests. I have with me Ms. Wilma Moore Black, and she is with CEO of WMB Creative. And we have with us Mr. David Parks, who is the son of Gordon Parks. And we're gonna share a little bit of insight regarding to the wonderful history of filmmaking with Gordon Parks, along with an upcoming event and opportunity that we would like to share with you today. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started with first with Ms. Wilma and share a little bit about what you do and how this is all tying together, your role with Tallgrass Film Festival, your role with Mr. David Parks, and some of the history that you have here locally in filmmaking.
Okay. I would have to start out with the fact that Gordon Parks has been a mentor of mine for years. Mm-hmm. As a Wichita native, I love to write and do, and he is just talented. In my opinion, he is one of the most gifted human beings who happens to be a Black man from Fort Scott, Kansas. He's a filmmaker, author. He was the first director, producer, and writer of a major film, Shaft, which happens to be this in its 50th anniversary. And he's just one where you read about him, you learned about him, and you wouldn't have thought that he was from Fort Scott, Kansas, but he is. And as far as staying in the career, I just love to write, had the gift of gab. and that was just one of those things that was profitable for me. I've done it for years, and I started at Ingalls. I was writing poetry, and at Matheson, and East High. And then I got on board at the East High School's newspaper, and the Wichita Eagle kind of adopted me. They sent me off to the William Allen White School of Journalism, camps for journalists, and the Midwestern Music and Art Camp, and got some awards there, photography and writing, and things excelled from there. Then I went on to summer at KU, and then K-State offered me a full scholarship and I transferred and they called me a traitor, but it really didn't matter. It's just that I needed the formal education because I happened to be a first generation kid. I just didn't have the money to go off to school and get those things, but I was determined to get my degree.
And so of all of what you've shared, your journey, challenges, and the way you've overcome some obstacles and excelled in many, many ways, I'm always in awe of all the things that I learn about you every time I have a chance to visit with you. This has led you up now to where you are today, and you work with Mr. David Parks, and share a little bit about your relationship, and then we're going to hand it off to Mr. Parks and hear a little bit more about his reflection regarding filmmaking.
Okay. I met David in Fort Scott, Kansas at the celebration of Gordon Parks Days that they have every year mm-hmm. in October.
Yes.
Down at the Gordon Parks Museum at Fort State Community College. And during one of the celebrations, we talked, we met, and other people from Wichita were there, and I was inspired. And I said, let's keep talking, let's discuss. And so then I brought him in when I was working at Wichita State. He came in and spoke to the students. He was one of our guest speakers, and it was conversations with David talking about his dad and the legacy and how he had influenced him and their careers together. And ever since then, and then I became David's publicist. So now promoting him and getting him to speaking into schools across the country named in honor of his father, Gordon Parks. And we want to, here in Wichita, they have Gordon Parks Academy. Mm-hmm. And just to see the delight and the joy that these young children have when he goes over there to speak every year. And knowing that this school is named after Gordon Parks, and here's his son right here in front of you. We make David available to all age groups at the school from kindergarten to the sixth grade. They get to talk to him, they answer questions, and he just has a good time. That's one of the gifts he has, is talking and celebrating and sharing.
Fabulous, fabulous. Well, Mr. David Parks, welcome.
Well, thank you for having me.
We are so excited to have you with us today. And
thank you.
That was such a wonderful introduction from Miss Wilma. Share a little bit about yourself, what you're doing as a filmmaker, and maybe share a little bit about your experiences and the legacy of Mr. Gordon Parks as it relates to Black filmmaking.
Okay. Well, first of all, I'd like to say that Wilma is just about the best in the totem pole. I mean, she and I have been working together for a number of years now, and around Kansas, and Wichita State, Kansas State, Gordon Parks Academy, Gordon Parks Elementary School in Kansas City, Missouri, and the Gordon Parks High School in St. Paul, Minnesota. St. Paul, Minneapolis, same thing, right? And she has been really great to work with, and she has a lot of energy for what we're doing, and she really loves my old man, and I love him too. Well, no, I was gonna correct a few things about Willem. The first major motion picture wasn't Shaft; it was The Learning Tree.
Okay.
That was at Warner Brothers in '68. And then Shaft was after that, okay? And then he went on and did, a few more Shafts and Lead Belly and the Solomon Northrup film. And so he did a lot of feature films that I was privileged to work on in various capacities.
So share a little bit for young, inspiring filmmakers, what did you learn as a young filmmaker, and how is that, you know, in your career working with your dad and others? Share a little bit about that experience.
Well, you know, I started out in the film business back in '62. First film I worked on was Walk on the Wild Side, which was a film directed by Ed Dimitrick. It was actually the first film that they introduced the soundtrack for movies. So that was quite, Jane Fonda was in it, Cappuccino, and I learned a lot. I got the bug there, okay? And then went off to Vietnam, came back, went to Rochester Institute of Technology, a film, and then went on to work on movies with my brother, Gordon Parks Jr., Superfly, and worked with Dad, and learned a lot working on those films with them. And one of the interesting things that I learned was keep it simple, stupid. You know what I'm saying? And that might sound flip, but you have to keep it simple and concentrate on what you're doing rather than what you would like to do. And that's kind of things. I worked on a lot of film. I spent 20 years working on film, and now I'm independent and I'm doing my own films.
So what makes a great film?
A good idea. You can start out with that, a good idea that makes sense. And but the idea is, it really is the most important thing, I feel. And once you have the idea, then you build off of that, okay? And, you know, try to keep it simple. Don't make it up. You know, just go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Keep it simple, you know?
Okay. And so tell a little bit about if a young aspiring filmmaker was, you know, listening to you today, our conversation today, what would they need to do to get started? I mean, is there any barriers that they can, maybe you can give them some advice about, or how would you proceed?
Well, I would give them the same advice that I would have given them 20 years ago. If you really want to make film, you want to learn how to make film, you go to Hollywood. that's where it's all done. That's where you learn the craft, find out what you can do best, what you like, and go from there. But you got to work on film. You have to, apprentice with the filmmakers who are making movies and get a handle on it there. That's the best suggestion I can get. You know, and you go to Hollywood, and you can't get a job on a film, but you might be able to get a job in the studio, being a secretary or whatever. Get in the business, you know, and find out how it works.
So your dad, yes. So your dad didn't get a chance to start in Hollywood. Did he do his first film? You said was Learning Tree in Fort Scott, Kansas, correct?
Yeah. But he had the studio Warner Brothers behind him.
Okay.
Producing. See, there's producing, there's writing, there's directing, there's film photography. There's so many different aspects of the trade. You really should go out there and say, I want to be a cameraman. Well, that's what you should home in on. And then if something else comes along, don't be afraid to take it. But you have to know what you want to do in the film business and are making film, and then build from there.
What do you think your dad's favorite part was of the film business?
Oh, man. He's kind of a different apple. He started out writing the book, The Learning Tree. And then he went on and wrote the script and did the music. He's really a good musician, classical, jazz, you name it, and did the music. He sort of ad-libbed the whole thing, never having worked on a film before. He had been around filmmaking because he was working for Life and Magazine, for example. They would send him out on assignments to shoot Marlon Brando or Sidney Poitier, and he was around the film business shooting stills, and he learned a lot from that, and so did I. I worked on film shooting for PR and stuff like that, and picked up a lot.
David, why don't you tell us a little bit about Shaft? There was the first version and the second one came out. And if memory serves me right, they had a clip in there of your dad. They pulled it in there. Share with us what you think.
Yeah, he was actually in the first one, too. He had a little cameo. And he always put himself in the movies, you know, that he made. And so he sort of played with that on a few of the films he worked on. And, but, you know, they've done, I don't know, about six major motion pictures today to right to this day, this year on Shaft. Okay. And Shaft's a classic. I mean, it has endured 50 years of revisions and redones, and it just doesn't stop coming. You know, when we shot the first one was in New York City, and from that point on, that it just actually what happened was he did Shaft made in 2 weeks over about $50 million. Well, MGM was in the hole who produced the Shaft. And so he actually took them out of debt on that film. And then they went on and made more money. So, but MGM was broke, you know, and Shaft pulled them out of the hole.
That's a little known fact that Black exploitation is, I guess, the genre is what it was eventually labeled. But that's a little known fact that during that period, it was the African-American community and filmmakers who turned that whole industry around. And
absolutely,
though we don't get credit for it, it was very pivotal in saving Hollywood and then setting an giving an opportunity to tell our story from our perspectives, from our lens, from our from our position of power, if you will. You want to speak to that?
Well, yeah. Actually, the Black film makers back in the 70s and 60s, they pulled Hollywood out of the hole, you know? And, but, you know, you take a guy like Melvin Van Peebles, who produced 13 plays on Broadway that were total successes, and Broadway was in trouble, and those plays pulled them out of the hole. So it seems like we keep pulling people out of the hole. But that's the way it is. That's what happens, you know. And no, but yeah, I have a problem with Shaft being an exploitation film, because Shaft was a true film. They didn't make it up. I mean, no, that script that they made into a film was an actual film that had a story that had happened, you know. And of course, it was nice to have Isaac Hayes do the soundtrack, and which was a blockbuster. And now you turn on the TV, Netflix, and all that, you see nothing but Black films. HBO, man, you turn the channel, you see. So we're making a move in it. You know, making a move. I don't know if we get much credit, but it doesn't make the credit don't make any difference. It's the bucks you put in your pocket.
Well, I appreciate you, David, for pivoting that term Black exploitation that I used earlier. So can you, this is a great time to reposition that, since that was somewhat the general description, if you will. I can't think of another word to say it. Help us understand better what that really is.
Since I think it was Hollywood. Yeah, I think it was Hollywood way of saying that we, the exploitation thing, although there were a lot of films that were exploitative, okay? But you got to understand, we don't, they used the Black films and called them exploitation because for whatever reason, didn't give us the credit that we deserved, but we got it, you know. Right now we're you know, you got Tyler Perry, you got all these other, Spike Lee and all that. I mean, we're just about ready to take it over again, you know.
Well, thank you for clearing that up.
Yeah, that exploitation thing was a kind of a under the carpet expression, you know. They didn't want to really give us the total credit of being filmmakers or storytellers. And that's, you know, but we're getting better, we're doing better.
We got a photo of your dad on a horse, and I know you took that photo. Can you tell us where it was taken? Why has he always got that pipe in his mouth?
Well, that's his trademark. You know, he loves, I mean, he's a pipe smoker. And that picture that I worked on for Paramount, took that for Paramount Movies. They hired me to do the promotional photography, which is public relations, et cetera, et cetera. I also worked as a production assistant to the producer. You know, I worked all around the films. And my father, I just didn't do one thing. And that was taken on Lead Belly. And it was a scene. He was getting ready to shoot a scene. He just came back having a little conversation with Roger Mosley. He came back, and I just caught it as he came back in, you know. they use it.
It's well, an iconic picture.
Yeah, they use that picture all the time. They use it in Half Past Autumn to open the book. And, you know, I have taken some good shots of my old man for his books that were published back in the early 60s, 70s. He liked my eye. He liked my brother. My brother took a lot of the photograph on the back of Choice of Weapons was my brother's. So we worked with Dad all our lives. Okay. When he was at Life magazine, we traveled around the world carrying his bags and loading his cameras and carrying lights. And we were a kind of a family company, so to speak, you know. So we had a lot of experience, you know, in the area of media and filmmaking.
Well, I wanted to visit a little bit with you and Wilma about an event that's happening here, Tallgrass Film Festival, and it is an annual festival that happens in October of each year. And this right. year is special because there is a new category for a filmmaker award. And Wilma, will you kind of share that, your role in that, and then maybe we can speak a little bit about your thoughts on it?
Gordon Parks Outstanding Black Filmmaker Award that the Tallgrass Film Festival is recognizing this year. It's a $5,000 prize award. Mm-hmm. Cargill Industries is a sponsor of that. And I'm a part of the Gordon Parks Steering Committee for this. And Denise, you're on that committee also. And I wanted to be involved because of the fact that I'm publicist for David and wanted to make sure that he was represented, involved, and could contribute all that he can do. He knows Richard Roundtree, Louis Gossett. He's still in touch with those people, mm-hmm. MGM Photos, and he's quite well connected with the filmmaking and industry and many of the people who, you know, traveled and circulated with his dad. So I felt with him being involved, he's on the committee. He's in partnership with the others that are doing this. And it's planned for October 20th to the 24th here in Wichita. And David's going to be one of the jurors for the winning submissions, and they will complete all that tally here in months to come and announce the winner in October. And David should be here in Wichita to present that in person and participate in the other activities they've got for the other entries.
Well, you know, that is really exciting that not only this recognition for young or just Black filmmakers in general, and my understanding, this is a worldwide opportunity. So anyone who identifies as African-American, is that correct? Or
correct. Share how that works. I'd say I'd like to really pitch to them to go to the website, mm-hmm. Tallgrass Film Festival website. You can do your entries. They're online. It's worldwide. They've got entries already from Italy, Africa, and a few other places. And they want to have a large response. It's an honor and a tribute to Gordon. And being that, you know, he's a Kansas native, I'm just excited that they're giving him that recognition and that David will be a part of it in honor of his father so that he can know that we really care about him. We're excited. We mm-hmm. respect him. I could tell you, the guy's a genius. He was far beyond his time. He didn't even realize how gifted he was. He worked tirelessly. He was a perfectionist to get things done. And these people who submit to the award, Filmmakers Award here will share what they know about him, his style, what they respect about him, and his gift and art of filmmaking. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited and glad that Tallgrass Film Festival has decided to make this a part of this year's event.
I'm excited about it too, because I think it's a long time coming. Mm-hmm. And certainly anyone who is worthy of receiving this award certainly would have to demonstrate the same passion and commitment and gift and talent and all those things that Mr. Gordon Parks shared with us, because his legacy is within all of us. You know, David, you said earlier, or maybe it was you, Wilma, that talked about those who are benefiting Spike Lee and Tyler Perry and many other filmmakers. That all kind of is a reflection on the wonderful industry and work that your dad really kind of carved out for us. Don't you agree?
Yeah, in more ways than one. When we did Shaft, and he did The Learning Tree, my brother did Superfly. He directed that. I helped produce it, raise some money. Aaron Loves Angela. My brother did about six or seven major motion pictures. And one of the things that's really important is that we were getting Black filmmakers into the union. One way to get in the union, you have to work on film, you know. So we were getting a lot of Black filmmakers qualified to be in the movie industry. Today it's more independent. You don't have to have union recognition. But in those days, you had to be in the union to work on movies. So my father and my brother and a number of other, Ossie Davis, really big. Ossie Davis, really big in getting Black kids in the film business. And Ruby Dee and Lou Gossett. I mean, I can go on and on and on. That worked with Dad and said, look, I ain't going to shoot the film unless I have at least 50% Blacks on the film, mm-hmm. working in various capacities. So he demanded that. So did my brother. And and that was one of the criteria, because we were making a lot of money. You know, I mean, those films made, I would say Shaft, the original, and the sequels that he did had made over $100 million. That's a lot of money in the movie industry. And they're still making them. They're still making Shaft and Superfly. Superfly was on last year. They did a remake of that. And, you know, you got a lot of people that, Melvin Van Peebles, who's probably the first Black filmmaker to make it independently. He made it independently. Then he went on to be accepted by the studios. But Dad and Ozzy and those guys worked hard to get him into the studio. It's not easy to get in the studio. My father was, when he did The Learning Tree, it took a number of different big names. Kirk Douglas had to go in there and fight for him. Marlon Brando had to go in there and fight for him. And they fought by saying, you got to give this man a chance. And when you have The Learning Tree, the book, which has been published in 20 different countries in different languages, that received the Pulitzer and all the accolades of journalism, you know, that's what happened. I mean, he just didn't walk into Hollywood and they say, okay, you can do this. No, there were a lot of people fighting for him.
Well, listen, we really appreciate your time today and sharing some thoughts and some insights and giving us a lot of history and helping us better understand African-American culture in filmmaking. We, of course, appreciate you as a filmmaker, and we can't wait to see you in October when you're here for the Tallgrass Film Festival in the honor of your dad, Gordon Parks, Outstanding Black Filmmaker Award. So we look forward to seeing you then. And we appreciate all the work that you do in the community and around the world with young children and filmmakers and those who have a maybe an interest or even a love or a passion. And so we appreciate that. And thank you for giving us time today. And Ms. Wilma, you want to share a few things before we close?
I'd like to say one thing, though. I'm glad to see Kansas is getting involved in the film business, okay? It's about time they step up and get a piece of the action, because there's a lot of good stories in Kansas. There's a lot of good people in Kansas that haven't been given the chance to experienced the world of film. So congratulations, Kansas. You know.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, David, so much. We appreciate your visit with us today. I'd just like to share a quote from Gordon Parks. It's called, "Enthusiasm is the electricity of life." Enthusiasm is the electricity of life. How do you get it? You act enthusiastic until you make it a habit. That's one of the things that's motivated me. You go on, I'm enthusiastic about this iconic guy who just worked tirelessly to do what he did, that he's done. And I'd like to just see his legacy continue on. Little children just wanting to be like Gordon Parks. He's a household word. And they're doing all that they can do to know that individually, if you work hard, it's going to make a difference. And I thank you for the time today, for addressing Gordon Parks, David Parks, and appreciate all that you do here at TCAM.
Well, thank you for joining us today. I appreciate both of you. And we also want to thank Tallgrass Film Festival for the opportunity to share more information about the Gordon Parks Outstanding Black Filmmaker Award. And you mentioned it early. Go to their website and find out how, if you are a Black filmmaker, how you can submit your work, your film work, to be considered for the award. And then also, if there's anything that we can share with you here at the Kansas African American Museum regarding history, education, heritage, and culture, and art, we would love to be a part of that with you. So join us at www.tcammuseum.org. And we appreciate you joining us today for TCAM Thursdays, your midday cultural break. Thank you.